Living Seed Media brings to you God's Word, which is His comprehensive equipment for changing lives. May the Lord impact your heart as you encounter His Word. For further inquiry or counsel, contact Peace House, P.O. Box 971, Boko, Benue State, Nigeria. Telephone numbers 0703-036-3659, 0703-768-1198. Email address lsmedia@livingseed.org or visit our website at www.livingseed.org. Let us sit back and listen as the servant of God brings forth the word of life.
Tonight, we're still going to go a bit further, still looking at the bonus of a coming revival, but we're going to keep illustrating as we begin to now highlight some of what they did, the response of the bonus. What is their response? And it is the response they gave to what God began to stir up in their lives that God blew upon, and it became a mighty, mighty outburst. So this night, I would just want to trace as much as we can, what was their response? The response, the requisite response that we must give in order for God's fire never to quench with us and in our lives, even as we lay down our lives. Hallelujah. I would like you to please go back to the book of Acts that we began to read. And I'm going to take it this time from verse 37 of chapter 2. Acts chapter 2 from verse 37. And we will go on to the end of that chapter. It would have been wonderful if we can just read all of chapter 3, all of chapter 4, up to chapter 5. But we will not be able to do that. We will only be drawing issues out of those chapters within the space of time that we have tonight. Verse 37. Now, when they heard this, they were pricked in their hearts, and said unto Peter and unto the rest of the apostles, Men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, Repent, and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, Save yourselves from this untoward generation. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in breaking of bread and in prayers. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. And all that believed were together and had all things common. And they sold their possessions and goods and parted them to all men, as every man has need. And they, continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily as should be saved. That's up to the end of chapter 2. Praise the Lord. Go to chapter 4. I just jumped chapter 3 because when we begin to refer to it, we shall highlight what was critical in their response. But go to chapter 4. I want you to go to chapter 4. I would like to read chapter 4 from verse 10. Verse 10. I will read a bit and jump. Be it known unto you all, and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him does this man stand here before you all. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled, and they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. And beholding the man which was healed standing with them, they could say nothing against it. But when they had commanded them to go aside out of the council, they conferred among themselves, saying, what shall we do to this man? For that indeed a notable miracle had been done by them is manifest to all them that dwell in Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it. But that it spread no further among the people, let us strictly threaten them that they speak henceforth to no man in this name. And they called them and commanded them not to speak at all, nor teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered and said unto them, whether it be right in the sight of God to hearken unto you more than unto God, judge ye. For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and we have heard. So when they had further threatened them, they let them go, finding nothing how they might punish them because of the people. For all men glorify God for that which was done. Being let go, they went to their company. This is verse 23. And reported all that the chief priests and elders had said to them. And when they heard that, they lifted up their voice to God with one accord and said, Lord, thou art God, which has made heaven and earth and the sea and all that in them is, and all the prayers they prayed. Now, would you like to go quickly to verse 32, verse 32 of chapter 4. And the multitude of them that believe were of one heart and of one soul, neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things out common. And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. and great grace was upon them all. Neither was there any among them that lacked, for as many as were possessors of lands or houses sold them, and brought the prices of the things that were sold, and laid them down at the apostles' feet, and distribution was made unto every man according as he has need. And Joseph, who by the apostles was so named Barnabas, which is being interpreted the son of consolation, a Levite, and of the country of Cyprus, having land, sold it, and brought the money, and laid it at the apostles' feet. May the Lord bring increase to his word in the name of Jesus Christ. The last passage, go to chapter 8. Just read chapter 8. And Saul, from verse 1, was consenting unto his death. And at that time there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem, and they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial, and made great lamentation over him. As for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering into every house, and hauling men and women, committed them to prison. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. Let's stop there. May the Lord increase his word in our hearts as we study together tonight in the name of Jesus Christ. I am looking at the response, the necessary response of the borners of revival. What was the response that the borners of revival, what did they give that caused the little flame that started to become an unquenchable mighty fire that swept their generation and up till now has continued to burn as the Lord continued to raise men for it? And there are a few things that I would like us to highlight as I'm highlighting them and praying that the Holy Spirit will give understanding and will give mobilization within your own heart as a person, as an individual, in expectation of what we are expecting God to break forth by your hand in the coming days, in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, the first point that I would like you to note, and I would like you to mark it very well. When Peter and the 11 stood up on the day of Pentecost, whereas there was a great phenomenon that has happened, they were all speaking in tongues, they were praising God, people were marveled because they heard them speak in the tongue in which they were born. And you could see the range of people that came. Some came from Libya, some came from Arabia, some came from Mesopotamia, some came from Pontus and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia in Egypt. Some came from Rome, some Crete. You know, they were all there. And they were all amazed. And it's like, what is this thing that we are seeing? In fact, the question the people are asking is, what meaneth this? What is this? Now, please, listen. I have discovered that many, many times when God begins to work in people's lives, and begin to bring spectacular things that draws the attention of people. The quiet deviation that several instruments that God will have used greatly to perpetuate his move is that they struggle to want to explain or, yes, try to dramatize the phenomenon. But may we say that what actually will perpetuate revival is not the outbursts. It is what is causing it to happen. So as soon as Peter stood up, I noticed that Peter did not bother to give a long teaching on speaking in tongues. Have you noticed that? He did not bother to explain that what you saw us saying, we are saying it by the Spirit, we are saying it by this. No. As soon as he stood up, I said, we are not drunk. This is that with the Holy Spirit. Which Joel, the prophet Joel, prophesied in those days that in the last days, I poured my Spirit upon all flesh. As soon as he said that, the immediate thing I noticed he began to do. Who knows what he began to do? He began to preach Jesus. He began to do what? To preach Jesus. It is very sobering for me to keep now recognizing that what brought revival, what saved souls and kept them permanently saved, was nothing apart from Jesus that was preached. Please listen. There are things I'm trusting that we will catch in our own response to what God is saying to us. I found that it is the preaching of Jesus that tore the hearts of the people. It was the persistent preaching of Jesus from that verse 22 up to verse 36 that Peter engaged in that brought conviction to the people that have heard. And as he began to speak about Jesus, something beyond him began to happen among the audience. The Bible said, as he went on and on and on and on, speaking about no one else but about Jesus, by the time you come to verse 31, 32, he said, this Jesus has got raised up, wherefore we all are witnesses. By the time you come to verse 36, therefore let all the house of Israel assuredly know that God has made that same Jesus whom ye crucified, both Lord and what? And Christ. And when they heard this, they were pricked in their hearts. And they said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? What I'm saying may look very simple, but I want to say it very carefully and yet strongly, that the preaching that will bring a sustainable revival, a sustainable move of God, must center, must focus, and must capitalize on Jesus and Him crucified. There are many, many, many preachings that is exciting in our time, to the extent that you might think that if we just keep preaching and teaching Jesus, will there be any serious, spectacular move of God? Don't we need to talk about many other things? Don't we need to explain so many other things? But I found that Jesus is God's message to mankind. So the first response I saw was how Peter stood up with the rest 11 and they preached what? Jesus. Now, when you go to chapter 3, when the cripple, by the power of God, was raised. Please be following this. Because as we press on in our response to what God is saying, several of these miracles, several of these signs and wonders, we also follow you in the name of Jesus Christ. I will say a few things about this because it's a critical response that I'm sensing God will want us to emphasize for each one of us as we move from here. Do you remember that when they were going to the church to pray and the crippled man saw them and was begging them for alms, and Peter said, silver and gold we have none, but what I have I give to you, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, do what? Rise up and walk. And the miracle took place. What I thought Peter will have been emphasizing will have been what? The miracle. I thought Peter would have been so excited that, yeah! And he would have been speaking about this miracle and be, you know, going up and down and say, you see, come and see, come for a meeting where the cripple walk, where the lame jump, and where the deaf are hearing. I thought that that was what they were doing. Even though these things were following them in abundance, they were very, very committed unto what is causing the miracles to happen. Oh, you are not getting me. You see, when the fire of revival breaks out, many good things will be coming along. But we will quench the fire, and we will quench ourselves When we turn around from what is causing the fire to come, and we turn to the flames. If we try to keep the flames, rather than what caused the fire to break forth, are we likely to keep the fire? It will faint. So I saw that even in chapter 3, the Bible said, and the man leaping up stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God. And they knew that it was that man that used to sit and beg for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened to him. Now I want you to follow. I'm reading chapter 3 and now in verse 11. And as the lame man which was healed heard Peter and John, all the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon's, greatly wondering. Now, these are critical response of these burners that we want to learn. Now, do you notice that if Peter had kept quiet, they would have been left wondering. They would have been looking at Peter with one kind of eye. I know they would have been quietly idolizing Peter in their hearts. Am I right? And somehow they would have been feeling good that, aha, God is moving with us now. And of course, the crippled man would have been with them. And I suppose what would have happened is that what they would have established now would have been a healing center. Now listen, you know why I'm spending time on this? It's because God said the enduring capacity of any revival does not depend on the effects. It depends on the burners. And because God has particularly said we have to focus on those who could cause the fire of revival to spread and to endure, that's why this meeting is a very critical meeting. In preparation for the kind of thing that God has promised that will break forth all over the land in a short while. Now, Peter could have established what? A healing center. And who are the people that will dominate that center? Those that are sick, those that are looking for miracles, those that have been told that when you come here, the man of God will pray for you, the man of God will do something to you, the man of God will do this for you. And do you know that when they have gathered like that, most of the time, please listen to me, most of the time, they do not hear any message. What are they waiting for? When the man of God will pray, when he will lay hands, when he will do this. And even when you see them rushing out, they are not rushing out for Jesus. They just want that thing to happen. They can keep themselves throughout the night. Say, maybe my own will happen at 1 a.m. Maybe my own will come at 2. They can be like that. And it can be a big crowd. And that is the quiet deception that kills revival instead of spreading it. So what was the response of these brothers? I'm dealing with their first response. Their response unto preaching Jesus, the one that causes the revival to break forth. Now, Peter, look at what he said in verse 12. And when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, ye men of Israel, why marvel you at this? And why look you so earnestly on us? Look at two questions he has asked. What is the first question? Why marvel you at what? At this. At what? At the miracle. I would say, Peter, somebody had been crippled for 40 years and is now standing, jumping, and dancing, and you say, why are we marveling at this? Is that not enough to marvel? Is that not enough for publicity? Is that not something you could say, let us all go. Let's go to GRA, where Brother Gbile is preaching. You will see the crippled man is there standing. In fact, you will see him there. Don't you think that would have been a very good publicity that would have brought people? Am I right? And if that happens, do you know that people will come from everywhere? They say, I heard. We heard. In fact, you will see that man. And when we do that, who becomes the center of attraction? The preacher and the miracle. Whenever we shift the center of attraction from he who caused things to happen, Jesus, we are at the verge of losing. Praise the Lord. Whenever the expectation of men was unwittingly shifted from Jesus, who is the one that causes all that has happened to happen, we are at the verge of quenching the fire. It doesn't happen. Nobody will feel, oh no, you are doing something bad. But that is a strategy that kills any move that God has brought. And when Peter saw it, his immediate response, because they said, he answered unto the people, you men of Israel, why marvel you at this? Or why look you so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness we had made this man to walk? What is the second issue he was dealing with? Who knows the second question he was asking there now? Eh? You know, if you are not focusing your attention on the miracle, who else will you focus your attention on? The miracle worker. Friends, the moment we permit people's attention to be shifted from him to us, no matter how innocently we think we are at the verge of quenching the fire. So I noticed that what they did, and I want you to follow me to see that throughout, that's what kept the fire. The man said, the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified who? His son, Jesus, whom you delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. But you denied the Holy One and the just and desired a murderer to be granted unto you. And you killed the Prince of Life, whom God has raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses. And his name, through faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know. Yea, the faith which is by him has given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. And now, brethren, I know that through ignorance you did it, as did also your rulers. But those things which God before has showed by the mouth of all his prophets, that Christ should suffer, he has so fulfilled. Repent ye therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, and he shall send Jesus Christ, whom before was preached unto you. Again, what has Peter done there? What did he do immediately? He redirected attention. He directed their focus to Jesus. I saw that these brothers were very sharp. They don't waste words. They don't waste time. Can you see how immediately at the end of verse 12, the next thing that Brother Peter was saying now, said the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob. You know, my mind was, he's going to start from the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. I thought maybe he would start preaching about Abraham. He would start talking about Isaac. He was trying to talk about Jacob, and that would have taken 3 hours. But did you see where he quickly landed? Where did he land now? As glorified his son Jesus, whom you, very confrontational. You people, you delivered him and denied him in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. You denied the Holy One and the just, and you desired a murderer to be granted to you. And you killed the Prince of Life, whom God has raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses. And his name, through faith in his name, has made this man strong. Did you see that? All the miracles that came in the revival never became their message. It never became their focus. It never became the emphasis. What was it? It was just a bait. And if God did it, immediately they turned their eyes from the man and from the miracle workers to the Lord. I want you to note that as their first response. Their response to preaching Jesus. Their commitment to preaching Jesus. Of explaining the work that Jesus Christ accomplished at Calvary. It was the key that opened the heavens, that opened the hearts of men, and that brought floods and floods of men to the kingdom of God. Now, let's see what was the result of what came during that meeting. Hallelujah. And as they spake, this is chapter 4, unto the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them. And being grieved that they taught the people and preached through Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they laid their hands on them and put them in hold until the next day, for it was now eventide. Albeit, many of them which heard the word, what has happened to them? They believed. And the number of the men was about how many? 5,000. And it came to pass on the morrow that their rulers and elders and scribes, all of these people, were gathered together at Jerusalem. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked, by what power or by what name have you done this? Before I take verse 8, I want you to see that Jesus is the message that will bring revival. Did you get me? Jesus is the message that has the capacity to change men. I have seen that we will preach prosperity, we will preach healing, we will preach deliverance, we will preach everything. And we will only mention the name of Jesus. That kind of message can cause sensation. It can make people to laugh. It can make a lot of excitement. It can even gather a crowd. But it cannot redound unto what? Unto a genuine revival. The only thing that causes lives of men to change is Jesus, whom they must hear, whom they must encounter, and whom they must meet. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Do you follow me to that point? Eh? Now, when they brought these brothers, even before the council, and they were asking them, querying them, by what power or by what name have you done this? Again, if you look at what Peter stood up to say, what was the long and short of what he began to say? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, he said to them, ye rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man by what means he is made whole, be it known to you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him does this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Let me ask you, did you see the commitment of these brothers unto only one thing? What is their message? Jesus. The bonus of that revival, they have only one message that overwhelmed their generation, and is Jesus. We don't hope to get any revival that will be enduring, that will last, if we should change, or if we should model up, or if we should say many other things that obscure Jesus as the center of our message. And as we are trusting God for the kind of outburst that God is speaking about to us, let me say that what will bring that outburst, what will sustain that outburst, is what? Jesus and him crucified. I was dealing with some of our brothers in the morning, and I was about to note that what we have been given to preach, what we have been told to teach, What we have been told to emphasize is Jesus. Now, some of you may think that if we don't preach miracle, we are not going to have miracles. It's not true. They didn't preach miracle. What did they preach? Was there miracles? There were miracles, and there will be miracles. Do you know that even in this meeting, there will be miracles? As we preach Jesus, as we point men to the man of Calvary, as their load of sin is dropping, even their troubles will fall off. Even their sicknesses will die off. Praise the Lord. Now, I'm just stressing their response. I just want you to know that it wasn't Peter alone that committed himself to this. All of them did. Now, what of Brother Stephen? What of Stephen? Do you know what they accused Stephen about that made them to want to stone him to death? They said in chapter 6, I think verse 13 and 14, they said, this man ceases not to speak blasphemous words against this holy place and the law, for we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth shall destroy this place and shall change the custom which Moses delivered to us. Even though they made up a lie, but I was still excited that when they were going to frame their lie, they still could not avoid one central thing that Brother Stephen was talking about. What is he talking about? Jesus. Now, but what draw my attention very strongly is not their own accusation, is to see Stephen when he stood up and they were to ask him what is his reply to this kind of accusation. They said, looking steadfastly on him, they saw his face as it had been the face of an angel. Then our brother began to speak. And he told a long story. And as he began the story, he was talking. He took the story from Abraham. He went from Abraham, how Abraham was called, how he had no child, how God spoke to him, how he begat Isaac, how he begat Jacob, how Jacob went to Egypt, as he told all the story. As he came on and on and on and on and on and on, he was pointing to them that even Moses, when Moses was in your midst, he was talking to you about another judge who will come. This is that which even Moses was pointing at. Then he moved and 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 moved, and he came to David. And by the time he came to David, and he was going to draw the word of God in verse 50. Has not my hand made all these things? You stiff naked and uncircumcised in heart and ears. You do always resist the Holy Ghost. And your fathers did this kind of thing, so you are also doing it. Which of the prophets did your father not kill? Do you know that as he spoke, when they heard these things, they were cut to the heart. they gnashed their teeth and they rushed on him. And he, being full of the Holy Ghost, he looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God, and he saw Jesus standing on the right hand of God. Now see what he said. And he said, behold, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. At that point, they couldn't keep quiet again. They were ready to kill him. What was he pointing to? Jesus. Jesus. Now, if you go to chapter 8, when the brethren were scattered all over, and we were told that they that were scattered abroad went everywhere, and what were they doing? Preaching the word. But now when you come to verse 5, you will see the kind of thing they preached. Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria. And what did he do, please? Eh? He preached Christ unto them. He preached Christ unto them. When the Lord sent him to go and meet the man, the eunuch, who was reading his own Bible, and the Holy Spirit said, join this chariot. What did the Bible say Peter did in verse 35? Philip. Then Philip opened his mouth and he began at the same scripture. And what did he do to this man? Please talk to me. And he preached Jesus to him. Let me suggest to you that all the places, there was one thing they committed themselves to, which was their own response to what God is doing in their lives. They preach Jesus. Before I go to the second response, which is also very critical, I want to ask, can we also make a commitment that for us, we will be fanatical about preaching Jesus? And that preaching Jesus, we will see what God will do if he will not confirm his word with signs and wonders following. The last point I was making was that it was Jesus they preached that brought about all that came. And even though preaching Jesus might look simplistic, in this time of sophisticated preachings, preaching Jesus may appear so weak because there are many, many motivational speakers that will say many, many things. I would like to say to you, the message that has capacity to spark an enduring revival is Jesus. Are we ourselves going to commit ourselves under God to preach nothing but him and him crucified? Let me say one more thing on that. If we commit ourselves to preaching Jesus, this land, if we will go everywhere saying nothing else apart from him and the man of Calvary crucified, if we will not tell any other story apart from the story of how he went to Calvary and died, we will see what we have never thought we could see. We will see a great move of God. We will see miracles. Because God will honor Jesus. He will honor his name. And we honor what he did at Calvary for mankind. That's the first thing I want to lay before you as bonus for the coming revival. If there was anything else, we can preach demons. Are you hearing me? The only thing that you will get, you may get crowd, but you will only leave them with fear. They will be going from one place to another looking for deliverance from fear. It never will bring revival. We may focus on money and prosperity. We will only have created in the heart of people an insatiable greed, a dissatisfaction that we make them struggle and they will never arrive. They can never have it enough. But may I say to you that preaching Jesus will make people prosperous. It will set them free from all their demonic oppression. For there is no other name given under heaven by which men will be saved apart from this name, Jesus. And the Bible says, it is through faith in his name that this man had been made strong. I'm trusting that by the time we are releasing ourselves to go, Jesus will be the message on your lips. Some of you, by God's grace, God will allow you to organize crusades in the villages, crusades in the marketplace. But when you stand up on the crusade ground, what is the message? Jesus. Jesus. Until people have heard of Jesus, they cannot be saved. They may hear about your stories. They may hear about how you went to Los Angeles and all of that. They won't be saved. They won't be saved. They may be afraid, they may be amused, but they will never, never be saved. And one of the critical problems is that the evangelical content, that is the gospel content in many of our messages, is very small. People are responding, but what they are responding to cannot save them because it's not the seed of the kingdom. Praise the Lord. Now, I said they did it all through. I have traced it to chapter 8. If I go with you to chapter 9, if I take you to chapter 11, and if we move to chapter 13, you will see Brother Paul. Also, they preached Jesus. And for Paul, he even said, I determined to know nothing among you except Christ and him crucified. Let's please, all of you, can you join me now? Let's read his own personal commitment, personal response to this matter in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and chapter 2. Let's quickly do that. And that will put that first issue to a conclusion for us. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and chapter 2. Now, when you go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, can I ask someone to please read verse 17, verse 18 for us? Then verse 22 and verse 23. Who will read it for us? And verse 24. 17, 18, 22, 23, 24. Who reads that for me?
Christ did not send me to baptize.
Uh-huh.
He sent me to tell the good news.
Yes.
And to tell it without using the language of human wisdom. In order to make sure that Christ's death on the cross is not robbed of its power.
Let me tell you. Christ's death on the cross has power. Please take note. Just to tell the story of how Christ died on the cross has power. Power to save. Power to deliver. Power to set men free. So he said, Christ did not send me to baptize. Even though we do baptisms, but that's not the first issue. But to preach the gospel, not with words, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. Go ahead, verse 18.
For the message about Christ's death on the cross is nonsense to those who are being lost. But for us who are being saved, it is God's power.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Did you hear that scripture? He said, for the preaching, repeat it. I think you are reading from Good News.
Yes, sir.
Are you reading from Good News?
Yes, sir.
Repeat it.
For the
I will beg somebody from King James to read, or NIV.
For the message about Christ's death on the cross is nonsense to those who are being lost. But for us who are being saved, it is God's power.
The message about Christ's death on the cross. How is it to those who are being lost?
It's nonsense.
Nonsense. And I'm telling you, maybe that's why even many of us preachers, we have been intimidated to think that to preach about that simple story that we're talking nonsense. So we are tempted to start talking something big. We are tempted to start preaching something. In fact, sometimes we will stand up and say, do you know what is happening in the world? Look, all of those things, they are information. They cannot bring transformation. What is it that is the power of God to save men?
Christ.
It's the cross. Where's King James? Thank you, brother. Let me get it from King James now.
For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom or words. Thus, the cross of Christ should be made of no effect. Verse 18. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to those who are being saved, it is the power of God.
Is that Old King James or New King
New
James?
New King James.
For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish, what? Foolishness. But unto us which are saved, it is what? It is the power of God. Brothers and sisters, let me say that. This coming revival, what we occasion it, what we cause it to grow, what we cause it to explode, is not anything else. It will not be anything else. I have been asking myself as I've been praying, I say, God, what is the peculiarity of this revival? And he says, Jesus. It is not world events. It is not politics. It is not poverty preaching. It is Jesus and Him crucified. That is the peculiarity of the coming revival. And the reason why discipleship is a very key strategy of the coming move of God is because what God is looking for the end time now are men and women that are growing to be conformed to the image of his Son. That he, Jesus, might be the first among many brethren. Now, before you sit down, can you read verse? And I want all of you to please mark this. I'm saying this night, believing that God, by the Holy Spirit, will give increase to it. And that it will sink into your spirit. Even though somehow, something say, no, you should have been talking to big people about this. But the Holy Spirit said, don't worry about that. When these men catch what to go and preach, they will see revival. That's why we are doing this now. Now, read verse 21, 22, 23, 24 for us. King James, man. New King James. Go on reading.
For since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, It pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believed.
May I remind you that preaching is still God's wisdom to save men. So no matter what we are talking about here, we must preach. Is that okay? For us to have revival in secondary schools, what must we do? We must go there and preach. And what do we preach?
Jesus.
And him crucified. For businessmen to be converted, we must do what?
Jesus.
And what must we preach?
Jesus.
And him crucified. For the villagers to repent, what must we preach?
Jesus.
And him crucified. God has chosen that by the preaching of the word of God, men shall be saved. We cannot reduce preaching and expect revival. So I found that they were committed. Read on quickly.
For the Jews request a sign,
uh-huh.
And Greeks seek after wisdom.
Now, I want you to see two things that is always dragging the work of God from one extreme to another. What is that? Two things. The Jews are looking for signs. The Greek are looking for wisdom. Two things. And these two things are always the things that derailed revival. And we're going to talk about how to deal with these two things as the Holy Spirit helps us in the coming days. Now, the first thing is that the Jews are asking for what? Signs. And do you know that many, many people, what they are looking for is what? Signs. To the extent that even some of us, we might, rather than preach Jesus, we might be preaching for signs. Because you think that if only people can see signs, everything will be all right. But you see, when the Jews have asked for signs, the philosophers, those who think they are intellectual, what are they asking for? So you see, sometimes the church moves to intellectualism. Because they are now trying to meet up with the intellectuals. They now think that gathering all these market women, let's say something big. So sometimes I see many of our pastors, they are going and going for more training that makes them more and more irrelevant. Are you understanding me now?
Yes.
The one that can preach simply and reach out people, once he goes for his master in divinity and doctor of divinity, and he comes and he says, Reverend Doctor, he cannot speak to us again. When he stands up to speak now, his message has become boring. Why? Because he's appealing to intellectualism. He's quoting so many books. He's talking about many, many philosophies. That at the end, when he finishes, you'll be wondering, what has he said? They're only good for the intellectuals. And even by intellect, they cannot save them. But if you are in any denomination, do you notice that that is the direction? Eh? Do you know that that is where the people are going? To prove that you are a big man, that is it. Churches, maybe not now here, but churches in the West, that's what they are looking for. And that's what they boast about. Our pastor is Reverend Doctor, this. And even those that didn't go to school, they are very eager to become what? Doctors. Reverend Doctor. The reason is that something is telling you, look, you are inferior. Preaching Jesus is not enough. You need to do something so that people will know you are a big man. No, let me tell you. What will make you great is Jesus.
Amen.
What will make men to hear you and they will tremble when you are preaching is when you preach Christ and Him crucified. And they will have been broken. They will have been knocked down on their knees before they will even think whether you went to school or not. That's how God has ordained it. Can we commit ourselves to preaching Him and Him crucified? No matter how educated the people are, let me tell you, don't appeal to their intellect. Preach Jesus. Preach the man of Calvary. You may not know how it will affect them. It is the power of God for saving men. Amen. Please finish up to verse 24. They require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom, but
we preach Christ crucified.
We preach Christ crucified.
To the Jews, a stumbling block.
Uh-huh.
And to the Greek, foolishness.
Yes.
But to those who are called,
but unto them which are called,
both Jews and Greeks.
Yes.
Christ, the power of God.
Uh-huh.
And the wisdom of God.
Amen.
Amen.
Can we commit ourselves to this? Can we commit ourselves to this? So let me ask you, what is the message of this coming revival? Christ and Him crucified. When we preach Him, every other thing that heaven can do to help men is inside that message. And God will convince you with this and help you in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, follow me back now. What is their second important response? What is it again that was their response that caused the revival? They were fearless. They fearlessly called men to repentance. Please note that. What did I say they did? They fearlessly called men to what? To repentance. What I have discovered is that nothing else will spread revival where there is no genuine repentance. Genuine repentance is a prerequisite for an enduring revival. May the Lord help me to say this very quickly and very carefully. Even though, please, revival can come with great singing. Revival sometimes comes with people dancing and beating drums. Sometimes you will see the effect of revival is that people become so happy. But may I tell you, all of those things are the effects. Hallelujah. They are not the cause. Just like I said, it is the preaching of Jesus and Him crucified that can cause men to be saved. I want to also now say, repentance. Genuine repentance that breaks the heart of men is critical for an enduring revival. May I say to you, one of the things that has brought weakness to the church, to the body of Christ, is that many people have been recruited into the church who did not come through the door of repentance. Are you hearing me? Many people, they are now in church singing, clapping hands, but they have never experienced what? Genuine repentance, heartbrokenness. Anytime you see a man that came into the purpose of God through a personal, genuine conviction that led him to repentance, one of the things you see him, excuse me, is that his follow-up is never difficult. You actually don't need to follow him up. Do you know what he will do? He is the one who will be following you. Whenever anybody is deeply convicted to the point of genuine repentance, those are men that has a story to tell as regards their revival. But do you know that because many people never really had occasion where they came under the conviction of sin that led them to serious repentance, that they wept and prayed even for 3 days, they never valued their salvation. They never regarded that anything spectacular has happened to them. They were just casual. And as a result of that, they never lost anything, even when they are bound. When they have lost their faith. To them, it's nothing because they didn't do anything to get it. I don't know how to say it, but I'm praying. I've been praying that God will allow us to experience revival that is an outburst of genuine repentance among us again. Those of you that remembered how your repentance came, how your conversion came out of serious repentance, you know that from that day, nobody persuaded you to read Bible. Does anybody have that kind of experience here? Let me see your hand up. Praise the Lord. I want you to expect that as you go, you will see people coming under the conviction of sin that will bring them to a genuine repentance from now in the name of Jesus Christ. Do you know that one thing in Thieveland that we must pray about seriously is this quasi attitude towards the word of God, that when you preach, hardly will you see anybody who will say no. Have you noticed that? When you finish preaching, the person will say, "Thank you very much. Pray for us." And you will have led him to actually pray the prayer of the sinner. Am I right? But he has not repented. Nothing has happened. You will say he has given his life to Christ. Go there next week. What do you discover? So to the extent that sometimes when we have preached, when you do a meeting, a crusade, and you say those who want to give their life to Christ, you see people running. And that may give you an impression that, we have got people. It's a quasi spirit. It's a religious spirit. And you don't understand. From the upbringing, I don't know how it happened. Something came in somewhere that made our people to feel that actually this repentance they are talking about, nobody can actually stop sinning. So when they say to them, what you're asking for is that who wants us to pray for him so that God will forgive him? And who does not want forgiveness? But whenever you see people that came under the conviction of sin, you did not need to tell them to put away their boyfriends. You did not need to tell them to pack away all the wrong disco music. It is not a matter of teaching that removes it. What removes it is repentance. Can we pray that we will see repentance? Can we pray that we will see tears again? A tearing of heart that confronts a sinner with his hopeless condition that makes him to cry to God, "Man, what must I do to be saved?" I thank God that several people are repenting and coming to the Lord. But I'm asking God that the repentance that we are looking for in the coming revival will be that is steeped in a deep conviction that will make men to hate sin. Do you know it is possible? Can we expect God to do that? And I want to assure you that even you, as you go, you will see it happen. As you start preaching Jesus in the name of Jesus Christ. I have seen violent conversions. Violent, genuine repentance that has happened to the point that me, myself, I was afraid. When I saw people, some, because the word of God hit them, they couldn't sleep throughout the night. They wept throughout to the point that I was thinking that maybe this message will make them mad. Praise the Lord. But I saw that what was God doing was that God was engaging in life and said, this thing you are doing, don't do it again. Don't do it again. And nobody could comfort them until the Holy Spirit came to their lives. So these men were committed unto a fearless demand for repentance in the lives of people. And may I say to you that as they do it, the response was definite. Is that not so? Look at that chapter 2. When they asked, because they were pricked in their hearts, and they said to Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Did you notice that Peter was not mincing words? He wasn't joking, he wasn't beating about the bush. What did he say? Repent! Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. I am not asking you to go about accusing people. But we must demand what? Repentance. Fearlessly. We must not be intimidated by people's size, by people's status, if we are looking for revival. One of the things that God did around 1977-78 here, which I met a relic of it, was that the brothers that God was using, men like John Unguze, something that is very critical about his message was his demand for what? For repentance. I sat in one of his meetings one day, and he just came, and you know, after the usual pleasantries that he would do that you don't know, when he settles on the word of God now, and he's shaking his head like this, and he landed, he said, repent or you will perish. And the entire meeting went stone dead. Silent. And as he pressed for repentance, fear gripped those that were sitting down. And with serious trembling, I saw people rushing with tears in their face. I said, yes. This was what God granted, that turned the heart of many young people over. I want to say again, that feature of a fearless demand for repentance is part of what God must do in restoring revival to us. Are we together? So I found that these brothers, they were committed. They demanded fearlessly for genuine repentance. Repent! Repent, every one of you. And as they did, look, 3,000, we were told, came. But as he was talking, he said, save yourself from this untoward generation. Then those that received his word gladly were baptized. And the same day, there were added to them, how many? 3,000 souls. Repent. Now, in chapter 3, When the miracle had taken place and people were marveling, when he came to verse 19, what did he say to them again? What did he say to them? Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. When the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, they ask for unconditional repentance. They didn't beg. They were not looking at me and say, well. And I found that weakness in the presentation of the word of God to demand for repentance because we are afraid that we may lose the crowd has made us to lose revival. Are you hearing me? There are people that we needed to tell to repent. But instead of asking for them to repent, we ask them to keep coming for discipleship. As if coming for discipleship was going to replace a genuine step of repentance. It will not. Praise the Lord. If we demand for genuine repentance, God Himself will reveal Himself to His people and they will be saved and they will never go back. So I find that the bonus of that revival, are we together? They did not. I don't know how to put it. I don't know what I want to say quickly. Because I'd like to say something that I think has happened to many, many of us. Sometimes we don't want to be unnice to people. Isn't it? Even when we are preaching the word of God, something tells us, don't be unnice. And don't be nasty. Be user-friendly. So somehow, when it is time to demand and say, brother, there is no hope unless you repent. We say, well, God understands. And that God loves you. Even though you are doing that thing. One thing I know is that God loves you and He will not reject you. Let's pray together. Do you know that the man has not said, God, have mercy on me. You are the one saying, Lord, have mercy on us. Sometimes you have not allowed the sinner to do what? To personally confess his own sin. You took over and said, Father, forgive us. For we are all sinners. Do you think the man will not say amen? Since it's about us. It's about all of us. But when you confront a sinner man, say, now, this is the hour of decision. You can't continue this way and hope that God will bless you. You cannot continue in sin and expect that the grace of God will abound on your life. You must take a decision here and now. If God will bring us to that point, I know two things will happen. And I tell you two things that may happen. We may see people genuinely repenting. We may see people reacting. I say, I don't want. Don't be discouraged when people react against your fearless demand for repentance. Don't be discouraged. You know what they are simply doing? They are kicking against the pricks. They can't do that for long. Sometimes somebody may walk away in annoyance. In annoyance. I don't like that kind of message. Do you think he will be able to sleep? He will not sleep. You will see him struggling. Say, but why do they say like that? Is it that? Are they the only people that are going to heaven? We are also going to heaven. If you are going to heaven, why are you struggling? It's no problem. Sometimes it is this thing that keeps him restless until he will meet another person who may not even say anything. But because what you have said has troubled him so much, he will just quickly come out and say, I want to give my life to Christ. Never you think that the reaction of people, sometimes their reaction is not simple, it's aggressive. Like the reaction that Stephen got. You know, it was wonderful to read Acts chapter 2 when Peter said, repent! And 3,000 repented. But wonderfully, in chapter 7, when this brother finished preaching, and said, oh, you stiff-necked people, you're always resisting the Holy Ghost. Repent! Instead of them to repent, what was their own response? They gnashed their teeth, rushed at him, and started casting stone. Do you know that it was a good response? Is it a good response? You don't like that one? Let me tell you, it's a response. It's a response, and it shows that something has touched them. You know, my biggest problem is when you finish preaching and there is no response. You don't know whether they have accepted what you said. You don't know whether they did not accept. When you finish, they only came to greet you. They say, ah, Jijingi, that's a good message. And they go. You know, for me, I'm more frustrated with that kind of response or no response than if they had stood up and said, we don't agree with what you are saying, you are a liar. How can you say that because I am married, there are three wives, I will not go to heaven. I'm going to heaven whether you like it or not. You know that is already what? A response. And they may go up and say, yeah, you tell somebody, I don't know. Even that they are saying that, you know, they are spreading the message. People say, why are you quarreling now? What is this? Don't mind it. That's why I don't go to peace house. It's a good response. Is it not a good response? Others will say, okay, let me even go there and see, and they will be helped. It's a good response. But this passive response, let's pray that God will deal with it. I want God to show you violent responses. I'm praying that as you go from here now, preaching Jesus and Him crucified, you will be getting serious responses. Those who want to repent, they will be repenting. Those who feel offended because of the preaching of the cross, they will violently react, and their reaction will cause more revival. Because as they are going, they will be talking. And as they are talking, others will be gathering. Isn't it? People say, what is it? What is it? What did he say to you? Why are you doing this? He said, don't mind him. Don't mind him. Imagine him saying that I need to give my life to Christ when I've been in church for many years. Sir, but why did he say that? Is that anybody who is not born again? I don't know their own kind of born again. I was baptized in 1952. Do you know that all of that response is going to redound into revival? We want to pray and say, God, take away passivity. Lukewarmness, take it away from us. There was a fearless demand for repentance. And I want to mark that with you that From Genesis, from Acts chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4, chapter 5, chapter 9, chapter 11, chapter 13, all through, they demanded for repentance. I hope you know that it was the repentance they demanded for that made the Ephesians, the people of Ephesus, to bring all their magic books, and they burnt it. As we begin to go again into villages, into the different parts of the land, in Idoma land, in southern Taraba, and in Tiv land, by the grace of God, we will begin to record genuine repentance in the name of Jesus Christ. As we go from villages to villages, we will begin to see disciples multiply. But it will be not just a gathering of people. It will be genuine repentance, drawing men to the kingdom of God. Do you believe God will do that for us? Are you expecting such a miracle? Do you know that repentance came to schools, and we saw schools, children in schools, in the secondary schools, in the universities, in the higher institutions in those days, we saw them written in pains because of conviction. I still remembered those that were affected in those meetings. They are still holding on. I want you to believe God that we will see glorious days again. Glorious days for me is not just people gathering and dancing and doing like this and doing like this. I'm longing to see when men will bow under the power of the word of God. When the Holy Spirit will sweep the land again. When critical resist, persecution came. Girls were beaten by their fathers because they have changed. Because they, you remember the girl that used to bring his parents, her parents, some food, some meat through sorcerer. When that girl repented, did you see how the parents were so annoyed with Paul and Silas? They said, "You have caused confusion. You have removed the food from our mouth. This girl is no more doing what we want." Praise the Lord. Do you know that their violent reaction was made them cast Paul and Silas to prison? And do you know that because of that, the prisoners, especially the prison warden and his family, were turned to the Lord? And when the man said, "What must I do to be saved?" What did they tell him? Repent. It's a message. They were committed to demand for a fearless demand for repentance. Genuine repentance. Genuine repentance. Fearless demand for repentance. Sometimes we are preaching to your colleagues, some of your friends. Don't be afraid to demand repentance. Don't say you will be annoyed. When God confronted you, do you remember that? You wept like a baby. Isn't it? You cried. And that is what made you to go looking for the word of God. And you forgot that you're a big man. None of your colleagues will be genuinely saved, though, if you did not demand repentance. Repentance sometimes is fearful, because the man say, "You mean that you want my life to, I have to redo all of these things?" Say, "Yes! Unless God helps you, you cannot make it." Let's demand repentance. It is repentance that led to restitution. Do you know that John the Baptist did not only demand for repentance, he demanded for what? Restitution. He said, those of you that have stolen, don't steal again. Those of you that have used force to confiscate people's goods, go and return it. Do you think we are going to see this kind of move again? Eh? We will. And I want to tell you that, and we will begin to see more of that from this year. The way the Holy Spirit had witnessed to our heart is that we are at the threshold. The time has come. Even though people like Thomas, people like Simon, people like, it will appear as if they were not ready, as if Jesus should start discipleship afresh. No, it was time. And they did well. Tell somebody, you will do well. Please permit me to take the third response. There are many others, but I'll take one more and then we'll pray together and stop tonight. What else was their response that brought, that spread the fire? And I want to talk about it very deliberately. If I cannot pursue it enough tonight, by God's grace, I must start with that tomorrow. What is it? In chapter 2, you will see it. In chapter 4, you will see it. And throughout, you will see it. Now, let me quickly draw it. Verse 42 to verse 47 is the point I want to raise. And they continued. How? How? Steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in breaking of bread and in prayers. Let me finish reading it. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. And all that believed were together and had all things common. And sold their possessions and goods and parted them to all men as every man had need. And they, continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. Father, that era is coming to us again. We are stepping into it afresh. Beginning with this place where you have put us in the name of Jesus Christ. What was this response? The third response. You could break this third response into many things, but I want to put it as one. They responded with a concerted, fervent teaching of the Word of God. I'm not sure I put it the way I wanted, but let me go on with that. I found that there was something that was breaking forth. It is that they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship. Hmm. You may think that there are many fellowships that is going on everywhere. You may think that there are many, many people going from one fellowship to another fellowship to another fellowship. And some of you may sense that, no, we have too many fellowships. And I will have honestly felt that we don't need to be doing things like this anymore. But I realize that for every genuine thing that God wants to do, the devil quickly multiplies counterfeits and occupies people with counterfeits and makes them to be so full of activities that has no bearing with what God wants to do in their lives. And from this time, there was a freshness coming to my spirit that we must resume again. We must resume again the concerted, consistent teaching of the basic doctrines that brought men to become great in the hand of God in their days. Please listen to me. Do you know that some years ago, we just sat down in this class, in this meeting, and we took the Sermon on the Mount. Do you remember? Few of you were there. And I was now beginning to catch myself, say, what you are talking about? We are talking about the time we spent 2 years continuously just on Christian home. And God was asking me, how many were there? Do you remember you did that about 20 years ago? I said, And in my head, I'm thinking that we have taught. And God simply said, those whom you taught have gone. The majority of people that are sitting here, there is little content. So I committed my heart. This meeting we are doing now, we are going to do it at least 4 times this year. It's not that we are not busy going up and down preaching, but I realize that yes, if revival is to be sustained and to be given capacity to burn, the wood that keeps it burning is the biblical doctrine that people have chewed that they are running with. Friends, there is excitement, but there is emptiness. There is singing. There is a lot of activities, but there is fluffiness. It's nothing. No content. No substance that can make a man strong. And I want to tell you that our young men, our young brothers and sisters, the youth, it's not that they want to be careless. They don't. They are serious. But nobody has given them content with which to run. Hallelujah. It is not that they would not have caught fire, but there was no steadfastness in the apostles' doctrine. I saw that these men, they could have just been celebrating the miracles. They could have just been carrying the crippled man up and down. But they knew that that is not the sustainability for the revival. What will sustain the revival? The word. The word. So what did they do? Look at what they did. they continued how? Steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship. Do you know that several of you are here now? You were not here when we spent a whole year on spiritual warfare. When we spent a whole year just studying Ephesians chapter 6, and we were looking at the weapons of our warfare one by one, and we dealt with the weapon not only of prayer, we dealt with the weapon of the blood, we dealt with the weapon of praise, we dealt with the weapon of the sword of the spirit. We went into such elaborateness of how do you study God's word and something comes out. Almost everyone we sat down with, they were capable of preparing Bible study outlines anywhere. And within that time, before the persecution that increased in the NKST church, some of you didn't know that what made the persecution in the church, and some of you are getting thrown out, was because a fire was entering. You forgot that we sent some of you to go join the catechism classes and just take Bible study. You remember the Bible study in the central, the Bible study here, the Bible study there, and people woke up, they say, wow! Something is happening here. Fire is here. We must stop it. I want to tell you again that for this new outburst, there is going to be an increased commitment unto the apostles' doctrine. Praise the Lord. The reason is because the wood that can keep the fire, it's not the excitement of the flame. Is that okay? It's not the flame. It's the doctrine that is bursting forth in fire. And these brothers were committed to it. So can I tell you, your floor groups, your discipleship meetings, they are not just going to be casual anymore. Hallelujah. They are going to be deliberate. We are going to start dealing with issues. We are going to be dealing with issues, not just reactions. We need to do that, and it must be going on in villages, it must be going on in cities, it must be going on in towns, and before you know it, this land will be engulfed with fire. They continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship. Fellowship. I still praise the Lord that there's a lot that God has kept, but it's going to explode. Fellowship. You know, this fellowship is a communion that made us, many of us, we became deep spiritual friends, flocking. You see, I saw something that God started as this matter began to grow in our midst. It's such that we don't bother where somebody comes from. There's fellowship. God is going to restore it. It's going to increase. This city, there's going to be an overwhelming fellowship of the brethren. People will move, and it will cut across churches and denominations and ministries. We will not know whether you come from that or that. We will just know that this is also a child of God. Fellowship. Do you know it will happen across the land? As those of you that came from Makurdi, you will see that, and I want you to pursue it. The brothers from Idoma land, you will see it afresh. It's not just going to end in the small office where we are. Fellowship, and in breaking of bread, and in prayers. Breaking of bread, and in prayers. Prayers was going on from house to house, because as the word of God broke forth upon them, it was the apostles' doctrine that brought about all the result. Fear came upon every man, every soul. Many wonders and signs were done by the apostles, because something was bursting in their lives. I am sensing, and as I share with you, that from city to city, as now I've seen some of you here, I've seen brethren from Zakibia, I've seen those that have come from Jota area and from the southern Taraba Wukari area and all of this, this fire will become unquenchable. Now, let's see how they grew. Let's see how they grew. Because I'm interested in what happened to them. The Bible said all that believed were together. They were together. There was oneness. There was communion. Amen. And there was commonness. Are we going to believe God that there will be togetherness? There will be commonness. There will be communion. There will be sharing. It was apostles' doctrine, are you hearing me, that made some of them to go and sell their possessions and goods and parted them to all men as every man had need. They were sharing things about those that had farms, those that had lands, many wonderful things. And they continuing daily with one accord in the temple. There was meetings. There was breaking forth again and again in their midst. And they were breaking bread from where? House to house. House to house. And they did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart. There was praise. There was singing everywhere. But what caused it was the word of God that they had been eating together. What again did you now see? There was favor. People began, they began to have favor with people, because when your way pleases God, even your enemies will be what? At peace with you. So how did they grow? How did they grow? Look at that verse 47. And the Lord did what? Added to them once a month, occasionally. How did they grow, please? Daily. Daily. Do you know why they were growing daily? God was working daily. Somebody is sharing the word of God in his office, and repentance is taking place, and he said, come. We are going for floor group this evening. And he comes there and he meets 5 or 6 or 10 brethren, and they all became his friends. And they were going from house to house. I remember that in the early times, some unbelieving husbands of some of our sisters, they were tired. You know what they were tired of? They were tired of disciples flocking their house. They could not just understand, as this one was leaving, another one was coming. One of them said, "This your people serve." I remember one in his reaction. In his reaction, he was telling, he said, "All this your people, they will not let somebody rest. Everyone is saying, we have not seen you. We have not seen you. I don't want to go there, but they're always asking." When finally I met him, he said, "Are you Brother Quile?" Everywhere in my house, it's only your cassettes. And all your people have been here. I wonder, I even thought you're a very old man. I didn't know that you are like this. I say yes. There were reactions, but we saw several of them coming to Christ. We saw several of them, they couldn't resist. Fellowship overwhelmed them. The love of the brethren conquered them. The grace of God in our midst melted them. Do you think we can still experience that?
Yes.
Much more. Much more. Visitation from house to house. And because when you sit in the house, the word of God is breaking for someone, say, "Let's just share this. Let's just share this." And do you know when some of the young men were repenting, their parents could not stay back. Some dragged their mothers here. Amen. Some went and brought their fathers. And we have seen wonderful things. We will see greater things. So tonight, I just want to stop with these three responses. They responded by preaching Jesus and Him crucified. They responded by demanding fearlessly for what? For genuine repentance. And they responded by a fervent, continuous commitment to the teaching of the word. They did it much more deliberately, because it is that was causing the fire to burn. Their multiplication was not done by any other means. It was because the word was coming. They were being confronted day and night with the truth, and they were acting on the word of God. They were praying together. They were fellowshipping. They were sharing. They experienced commonness. Nobody could be ridiculed in their midst, because the brethren were meeting the needs. I want to thank God that we have experienced a bit of that here. We are going to see more. I'm expecting that things will be happening, and brothers and sisters, some will be going to school, and nobody, their parents will say, "But who is sponsoring?" You say, "The brethren." Some people's parents died, and they were waiting and said, we will see. When the brethren went and overwhelmed the whole place, they said, "Who are these?" Said, "Those are my brethren." "Ah, you mean they are the ones doing all of this? Where are they from?" And from that point, we saw things, doors opening. May the Lord visit us again. This continued in chapter 4. I do not have space for tonight, but I stop on this. Three things that was their response. And if we also will respond, we will see the glory of God. I say we will see the glory of God.
Amen.
We will see multiplication in our days.
Amen.
And I want you to mark what I'm saying. It begins from this year. I'm going to request you to make your own response. I want to request that we, but first as individuals, then as a team of disciples in this region, we want to make a response that we will preach Jesus. We will confront everybody we meet on the street with the message of the cross. We will tell them how he died for them. Never you think that that message has become so common. It looks common, but it's still unknown. We will confront men with a fearless demand for repentance. Don't be afraid. Don't say, they will think my own is too much. Ask for them to repent. And when you see men break down under the word of God as you preach it, don't be afraid. It is the Lord at work. They committed themselves unto the apostles' doctrine. We're going to renew ourselves with the word. We're going to teach it. At a point I thought we have spoken too much and that we have learned too much. The word of God is too much here. And God said, be very careful. Be very careful. Don't throw away the only weapon that I've given you for this coming revival. Be very careful. Don't speak lightly. The fact that many people among us, they now have utterance, they can preach, they can teach the word of God. That was not to conglomerate in one place, is to send them out. They will be preaching and teaching from city to city, from village to village, and things will be happening. We will send you out. As we conclude this meeting, I'm trusting God that you will be released. You'll be released to run through cities, through villages, and we'll be coming back occasionally to talk about what God has done. Would you like to respond to God? Would you like to say, Lord, I am part of this. I am part of this. Renew my faith in the man of Calvary. Renew my confidence in the word of God that never fails. Stand up and join me as we pray together. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Permit me to pray first, and then I will ask you to pray. We're still going to pray a few minutes on these things that God is raising. Their own response, they preach Christ. Shall we pray together? Father, tonight, thank you for the opportunity of being alive at this time again. Thank you for the privilege of being counted among the bonus for this move of your spirit. Thank you for my brothers and sisters. Thank you for pastors. Some are leading different churches, but they are also disciples. And they are longing to see the outburst of your glory in the places where you are placing them. Thank you for those that we have insisted they must remain in these congregations because it is strategic. Thank you for those of us that you are placing in different locations, in different offices, because you are about to reap an harvest. Lord, I thank you tonight. I thank you for redefining what is the message that will bring revival. Thank you, God, for redefining for us what was their demand that brought revival. Thank you for showing us what was their preoccupation that fanned the fire of revival to flame. Lord, they preached Jesus. They demanded fearlessly for repentance. And they preoccupied themselves with the apostles' doctrine and fellowship. And we saw what you did. Tonight, Lord, on behalf of these brothers and sisters, and in response to your word, dealing with us as a team of men and women, raised up for this assignment in this generation, Lord, I ask that you will renew our own commitment. we renew our own response. We will preach and preach Christ and Him crucified. We will fill this land with the doctrine of Christ. We will speak it on rooftops. We will speak it in nooks and crannies of the land. We will speak Jesus in every opportunity you give to us. We will preach. We will preach. We will preach. We will preach the man of Calvary. We believe that your death, even though it appears like foolishness to those that are perishing, but to those of us, it is the power of God. Lord, we commit ourselves to this matter until we see your glory break forth in the name of Jesus. Lord, we will demand fearlessly for repentance. We will demand for men to make their way right with you. We will go with passion, knowing that unless men make peace with you, they cannot be at peace. In the market area, on the farms, in churches, in schools, wherever men are found, make us fearless in demanding for reconciliation between men and their maker. Lord, we commit ourselves to undiluted word of God. We thought we have done it too much. There came a time when we said, oh, all this. Lord, we repent for that. We want to recommit ourselves unto the word of God. We want to do it with all diligence. We want to fill the land with the truth until this land can no longer be kept in bondage. In the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, you know we taught on radio. We wrote tracts. We are asking that again, oh God. Men will not be changed unless they hear the truth. Lord, the truth will fill the land. Every place, oh God, you will cause your word to fill the land. The knowledge of God will fill this land even as waters cover the sea. Thank you, Father. As many as we can raise, as many as we can train, as many as we can prepare, give us opportunity to do so. We will break bread from house to house. There will be prayers everywhere. There will be commonness, fellowship, sharing, good works. Nobody will go hungry among us again. Lord, we are trusting that as we come pressing on this matter from tomorrow again, you will show us how to practically respond unto the issues that the men of old responded to and brought increase into their ministry. Thank you. Lord, as my brothers and sisters will be making personal response to you tonight, let the Spirit of God set them ablaze. Let the fire fall as it happened on the day of Pentecost. Thank you, Father. In Jesus Christ's name, we have prayed. Amen.